second place, they say. Think of all the television you can watch, they say. But it's not so easy. Less and less new stuff is coming out because all the productions had to shut down and the studios want to save their movies for theaters, or at least they're trying to hold out as long as they can. You don't want to spend any additional money. You've already spent it on a bunch of streaming services, right? You can't just waltz over to iTunes and watch whatever you want, or Amazon, right? I know a lot of you use Amazon. And then also, what have you not already seen? You've seen all the obvious stuff. I'm assuming you know how to read the front page of Disney Plus, right? But what else is there? Because when you try to dive deep, and we've all been there, you just sometimes end up watching crap, and you feel like your time is wasted. Wasted. But I'm here to help you out with a top 10 list of personal, off-the-beaten-path recommendations for Disney Plus. Tomorrow, I shall do Netflix. Netflix will actually be two different episodes, one for series and one for movies. But on Disney Plus, I mean, either you're into Goof Troop or Rescue Rangers or Gargoyles or X-Men or you're not. I mean, it's such a huge commitment. There's just so much of each show. I mean, it's up to you whether or not you want to go down that rabbit hole. But these are little one-offs. They just take care of an evening or an afternoon, right? Or 3 in the morning. Okay. All right, so first off, number one, finish the Imagineering story. Oh, one series did make it onto air. Now again, we're all in the same place here. I watched the first episode when the service launched, and I thought to myself, oh, that was very well done, but I already know all this. And then I skipped ahead so I could see Robot Spider-Man, who's very cool. Watch it for that reason alone. But don't skip ahead. Watch all the episodes. And I say that because last night I broke down. As I said, I'm here too. And I was like, fine, I need something short. I watched all the taped Simpsons and Family Guys that I had on my DVR. I shall watch another episode of The Imagineering Story. And it was fantastic. It was full of surprises, information I did not know, and some very moving anecdotes about people who'd worked on the theme parks. And it's also, by the way, a great way to not only witness the history of Disney itself as a company, but how it is to work at all companies. The mistakes they make, how they achieve their successes, often by accident, and how real people navigate between the two. It's rough, but it's really interesting. And you'll see again, we're all in the same boat. Now, on that note, number two, watch Waking Sleeping Beauty. I know it's a documentary, but everybody's into documentaries these days. It's fantastic. I've recommended this movie for years, but now you can watch it at no extra cost. Today, Jeffrey Katzenberg might be known for being kicked out of DreamWorks Animation when Comcast purchased it. We'll purchase it on one condition. You leave. Oh, that's got to be harsh. I mean, he did a really good job with DreamWorks for a while. And also, of course, Quibi seems to be DOA. But here, you will see how he pretty much single-handedly saved Disney Animation, all while being powered by Diet Coke. Who can't relate to that? Oh, it's great. It's a very juicy documentary. In some ways, it's surprising that it is on this streaming service, because it doesn't always make Disney look great. But it's fantastic, and it talks about how they ushered in the Disney Renaissance. Oh, it's good stuff. All right, the number three, speaking of the inner workings of Disney, hey, look at that! You can watch one of my top three movies of all time, Saving Mr. Banks. It's hard to have a stronger recommendation than that. Now, as the saying goes, and as I always tell you, a good compromise leaves neither party happy. And boy, were both Walt and P.L. Travers not happy. But the movie, their compromise, sure turned out good. And here's another behind-the-scenes juicy story about one of Disney's most successful films. How successful? Well, if you watched Imagineering Episode 2, you would know. Oh, that's a good little tidbit I'll leave for you to discover. Watch it. By the way, clearly you'll see while watching all this stuff that working at Disney is a bit of a cult. But what a cult! I was even tempted to sign up while I was watching these. I was like, wow, I could spend my whole day with Disney? There's a lot of drawbacks I can see, but oh, it's so great. All right, so if you have Disney Plus, you like Disney. All right, so number four. Here's your chance to watch another movie that didn't get its due, John Carter. Pixar's Andrew Stanton will never have a live-action movie career. So sad. But unlike Brad Bird, he actually made a good movie, which makes it even more unfair. And we all know that Mission Impossible was only okay. I mean, it got really good reviews. Here's a bit of some juicy stuff for you. The only reason it got amazing reviews, and it did have very good action set pieces, by the way, but the only reason the movie got great reviews is that they flew everybody to Dubai for the press junket. So, they cheated a little bit there. All right, so because I think Andrew Stanton actually, though, delivered a fully functioning movie that needed no excuses, although maybe they should have had some. Ah, that was a disaster. There was also a new marketing lady who was working at Disney at the time, and she didn't last very long. But before she left or was fired, she took this movie down with her. All right, and poor Andrew Stanton. Now, John Carter is the story that inspired Superman, but Superman got to mainstream audiences first. And he inspired other stories as well, John Carter, but Superman, interestingly, is reverse John Carter. Very clever. And this is definitely worth watching. You too can feel bad that they never made a sequel. All right, now number five. Do you like Chris Pine? I like Chris Pine. Who doesn't like Chris Pine? Well, he made this movie for Disney, The Finest Hours, before he became everyone's favorite love interest in the Wonder Woman movies. I can't wait to see Wonder Woman 1984 eventually. But The Finest Hours is in fact chock full of underappreciated actors. Ben Foster, Eric Bana, and depending on who you believe as to whether or not you like him, Casey Affleck. He's a very talented actor. He's very good in this movie. It's a complex. Well, this is a happy video. We won't talk about any of that stuff here. Now, the Massachusetts accents are thick. Some of them, not that good, but it's fun. And if you've got access to soup, well, then I recommend you heat up a cup to watch this movie. When I saw it in theaters, I was like, I either should have snuck in a McDonald's fish sandwich or some clam chowder. I told you, thick, bad accents. All right, now, speaking of groups of guys dealing with a disaster, how about talk about off the beaten path, number six, Three Men and a Baby. I'm seriously recommending this. Hold on. So it's based on a French hit, and this was a hit too. In fact, the most successful movie of 1987. In your face, Fatal Attraction. And it's directed by Leonard Nimoy. Seriously, I recently watched this myself because I'm sheltering in place too, and I was like, wow, this was a really successful movie. I'll try it again. I don't remember it at all. I think I saw it like a long time ago, obviously. And Leonard Nimoy's name came up and I was like, what? Paused it, looked it up. It was Spock. And of course, there's also the Dr. Spock's baby book. It's a different Spock, but it's funny. All right, so anyway, I almost turned this movie off in the beginning because it's like super dated and has some kind of like not great attitudes towards women. But when the baby showed up, boy, did this thing take off. I couldn't stop watching. In fact, I enjoyed it so much. I was like, I got a little bit too greedy. And I was like, let me watch Three Men and a Little Lady, even though it's like 2 a.m. I'll watch it. It'll be fun. It was horrible. Although Fiona Shaw is in that movie, being absolutely hilariously bad. And it's funny to think that she was in that movie playing that role and then went on to Killing Eve. She truly did deserve, I think she won like the BAFTA, right? She truly deserved that. She's very good. Now, Disney, for some reason, is thinking of remaking it for the streaming service, but not only do I think it would be difficult to recapture the magic of this cast, they couldn't even recapture the magic for a sequel themselves, but when you watch the movie, you'll see it's like a dated concept and the way it all comes together. I don't know if you can do that today. All right, now, of course, I mean, I can't tell you how many hijinks were helped by the fact that nobody had emails or cell phones, right? Just watch old episodes of Seinfeld for further proof. All right, now, of course, right now, you want a movie that makes you feel good. That's why you're on Disney Plus and you're interested in watching Disney. Well, number seven is Pollyanna, and that'll do the trick, too. That's right. Right now, we all need the Glad Game. And if you watch this movie, you'll know what the Glad Game is. I love the Glad Game. I myself play it all the time. Not all the time, but a decent amount of time. I like it. There's a lot of talk about how Kurt Russell, who showed up also, he popped up out of nowhere in Imagineering Episode 2. But Kurt Russell, of course, was a big child star for Disney. One of the last things he ever wrote down before he passed away, as legend tells it. And I believe that legend is true. But anyway, Hayley Mills was also a huge child star and a female star for Disney. She's so talented. I love The Parent Trap, but I'm recommending Pollyanna. And this was her big breakout role. It was really her first official role. She'd only previously been in a small project with her father, also a famous actor, that Disney happened to watch for her dad and was like, who's this kid? She must work for me. And it turned out to be a great partnership. Do you like Main Street USA? Who doesn't like Main Street USA? If you don't, that's sad. But if you do like it, this is the movie equivalent. If you can get your hands on some cake, they pass out some awesome cake during the fair at the end of the movie. I always feel bad I don't have cake when I watch it. I don't know where you could get cake that big these days. They don't even sell it on Main Street anymore. Finally, because it's Disney, I gotta recommend some animated movies. And quite frankly, if you're really committed to entertaining yourself, you should be working your way through the whole lot right now. In fact, a BTT viewer recently shared that that's exactly what he was doing on a recent viewer call-in show every Sunday at around 10:30 a.m. But anyway, here I thought I'd recommend some animated Disney movies that you might not have seen a gabillion times. And maybe, just maybe, never at all. Oh, that would be great. All right, so number 8, Oliver and Company. I myself, again, I'm recommending what I watch myself here. I watched this the other night. Boy, did it put a smile on my face. I wasn't sure. I dragged my feet a little, but as soon as it started, I was like, I made a good choice. This is fantastic. And it was. The musical numbers are sensational. The opening number, sung by Huey Lewis, written by Howard Ashman. You can't get the soundtrack on anywhere for some stupid reason, but someone uploaded a bunch of clips illegally to YouTube. Ooh, and I was particularly listening to this opening number after I watched the movie a couple of times. I liked it so much. Big musical numbers for both Billy Joel and Bette Midler, who also voiced their characters. That Billy Joel, not a bad actor. And one of the Pointer Sisters. Plus, if you don't laugh at Cheech Marin's jokes, you're made of stone. He's so funny. You're also going to bust a gut watching number 9, The Emperor's New Groove. Oh, this is such a funny movie. Eartha Kitt and Patrick Warburton are as funny as any live-action movie. So many quotable jokes. You'll probably at this point watch the movie if you haven't seen it and be like, oh my god, that's where that joke comes from. David Spade and John Goodman are also in top form. No touchy! I love this movie. And it really is one of my favorite Disney animated films. When it came out, I went with some friends, and I was laughing so hard I actually fell out of my seat at a movie theater. And you know what kind of a germaphobe I am? And the fact that I risked falling on the floor just shows how good this movie is. I think the only other movie that I ever laughed that hard watching was Army of Darkness. what a combination! All right, so anyway, finally, number 10 is a Disney Princess 1-2 punch. All right, so toward the end of my recent trip to Los Angeles, it started out just fine, but then it got more and more corona-y as the country started to freak out. So toward the end of my trip, I was there through Sunday. So Friday and Saturday, I couldn't leave my hotel. Okay, I was stuck in there. So I watched these two movies, and I have to say they both made me really, really happy, all right? It was like Friday afternoon, all day Saturday. And so I think Friday night I watched one of these movies, and then Saturday morning I watched the other. So it was fantastic, right? So Tangled, right, about a sheltering-in-place princess of the Kingdom of Corona. The internet's been having a field day with that one, and it feels so right watching it. You're like, whoa, this is very, very accurate. It's the animated Contagion, or the fairy tale version of the fantasy version of Contagion. And then The Princess and the Frog. Oh, this is great. This is how 2D animation went out at Disney, and it went out good, went out strong. I love this film. It's a lovely 2D animated film with really great artistry, and it has one of the best Disney villain musical numbers of all time. Friends on the Other Side, right? Are you enjoying Keith David as Spawn? Did you enjoy him in Gargoyles? Well, check him out here. I'm so happy to see his character become more popular over the years and become a part of like all the Disney villain events, because he's just a really great character. All right, so those are my personal off-the-beaten-path Disney Plus recommendations. And of course, share your own down below. Help each other out. And stay tuned for my Netflix recommendations, of course, tomorrow. And you know how you can make sure you don't miss those videos? Hit subscribe! And also click that little belly thing so that it sends you notifications and stuff like that. Turn on the notifications. It sends you a cute little email. You get to see the poster frame all nicely presented there. Then you just click and you can watch the video. And of course, as always, you could click on some other videos, some more videos, right now.